Felicitación. Father, even as you have called us, led us this evening to be here to remember our Lord Jesus Christ, grant us this grace, O Father, that even as we are gathered in the name of Christ, that this evening we will receive this fresh revelation of the person of Christ and of his sacrificial death for each and every one of us. We commit this whole service into your loving hands, O Father, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I have titled my message, The Forgiveness of Sin. And my main trust and focus this evening is on the word forgiveness. I am not too sure about all of you, and I am not too sure about many of us. It seems that when I relate with people, generally I find people are all quite alright together. They seem to be generally laughing in their heart with people, and that is the answer, the politically correct answer. See, I want to start not with other people. I want to set my message on my own testimony. I struggle with anger. I am not too sure how many of you can identify with me, but I do struggle. And I had one very serious bout of it in the year 1998, 1999, and the year 2000. It was over a three-year period. I struggled, and I wondered during those times, how did I get into this black hole. I couldn't get out of it. It started with some anger, and then along the way, back into strong sense of unforgiveness. And then I think I grew into it. I didn't know it would go that far. You know it for that part. And if you were to ask me, I really, really wanted to forgive. But I couldn't. And I tried all the spiritual mechanics. And meaning, I read the Word of God. I pray, I worship, I even went to the Penang Bridge once, drive along the bridge, drive back, struggle, was one fine morning, a Sunday morning, I was there, with that road. Texas. I can remember this paper. I just can't remember it. They think it was worse than all of them. I said that. Sometimes I look it out, but for a while, I think we can stop the people for a while. The Lord is with us. And you know, finally, that there will be some of us tonight who may struggle. We sometimes put it aside. And when I say you may struggle with this, I am talking about for some reason you may have struggled with it for many years. It may be someone that you used to love. It may be someone you used to relate with. It may be someone you're relating with now that you struggle with this issue of unforgiveness. And today, on this Good Friday where we want to remember our Lord, I want to focus on the forgiveness of sin. And all began more than 2,000 years ago, one fine Friday. And I want to begin with this piece of scripture, Luke chapter 24, verses 45 to 47. Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. Jesus was talking with his disciples, and he opened up their minds after the resurrection. In 46, he told them, this is what is written, the Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And verse 47, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations beginning at Jerusalem. And this is where I draw the title of this message, the forgiveness of sins. But I want to begin with our Lord Jesus Christ. And the scripture in verse 46 tells us that he will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. This is the sense of the gospel. It refers to the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I want to turn to that description of the Friday, and I want to look at Mark chapter 15. In Mark chapter 15, verses 33 until 38. In verse 33, at the sixth hour, Mark chapter 15, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. And verse 34, and at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? And verse 35, when some of those standing near heard this, they said, listen, he is calling Elijah. Verse 36, one man ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, and put it on a stick and offered it to Jesus to drink. Now leave him alone, let's see if Elijah comes to take him down. And verse 37, with a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. And in verse 38, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. In verse 33, it says, at the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. This is in Jewish reckoning. And the sixth hour is Job noon. The ninth hour is preaching. But the whole episode of Jesus on the cross started on the Jewish third hour, which is 9 a.m. in the morning. So I want you to try to capture what happened
2,000 years ago. Now, today, the time has come. I'm also this lonely. But I pray that God will give us a revelation, a sort of vision of what it was like for Jesus that he hung on the cross. Because all our faith actually rests on that work of Jesus on the cross. That we come into the presence of God, we are able to be called His sons and daughters because the Son of God came down and on that fateful Friday, He hung there for the wrath of God. Everything begins from there. One of the things that God brings to mind, sometimes we, after becoming Christian for a long time, we may tend to think, is there a fresh insight? Is there something new? Is there something more to the scripture? But at the end of the day, I want to remind all of us, everything we want begins in fact, the reading of the Bible as we have it now, as Calvary, as the fundamental reference. If you read and study the Bible along the way, you will come along a statement like this, that the Old Testament must be read looking forward to the death and the resurrection. That it is the death of Jesus and His resurrection 3 days later that will define how we read the Old Testament. But on this side of the cross, for people like us in the era after the cross, the New Testament is also read in the light of Calvary. And I used to draw this diagram. I put Calvary up there with the big cross of Jesus on the cross. And on this side, we have the OT people looking up to the cross. And on this side, after the cross, we have the NT people here looking at the cross. Our walk with God, how we grow with Him, how the church actually will be defined, will always, always come down this Good Friday in relation with His third son. So today, I want to look into those 6 hours. Pontius Pilate was trying so hard to release Jesus. In fact, he was a little bit scared. Even though probably he didn't believe much in God, there was something in him that made him a little bit scared. Until at the end of the day, when he had to give that order for Jesus to be crucified, he got a basin of water and he really literally used that clean water and washed his hands to tell them, I am innocent of the blood of this man. Because I see nothing wrong with it. And that order was given at 9 a.m. in that fateful morning, Jesus was lifted up on the cross. From 9 until 12, those 3 hours, bit by bit, you will see Jesus slowly experiencing the physical pain, the emotional pain being multiplied, the spiritual pain being enhanced, until verse 33 of the 15th chapter of the book of Mark
says, at the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. The sweep of the judgment of God slowly reached an intensity at 12 noon. And that intensity of the judgment and the wrath of God was relentless. That is the word we always use when we describe the suffering of Jesus. It was relentless, meaning that there was no time when it actually abated or subsided. From 12 noon until 3 p.m., it was wave after wave of the wrath of God. You must understand that when Jesus hung on the cross, a man without sin, a man in his life who has done no wrong, a man in whom holiness defines his character, and there, when he hung on the cross, he was at his lowest defense in the sense of the very fact that he was physically in pain. And many of his disciples abandoned him. And many who actually sang praises of him when he entered Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday now deserted him. Some of them mocked him, him, you will find there was so much emotional pain. But beyond all that, a description of what happened to the cross always focuses on the very fact that the deepest suffering that Jesus bore was the intensity and the weight of the sin of the world upon him. You must understand that to a holy God, and Jesus is the perfect God and the perfect man, that sin is an anathema to the holiness of God. It is something that is repulsive to him, repugnant to him. It is something that really he draws away. And while he was on the cross, what was happening is the sins of the world, one level, was poured upon him. And he was bearing that spiritual pain. But beyond that spiritual pain, what was happening is it was not just the sin that was being poured by him. It was not about the weight and the intensity of the sin per se. It was the very fact that as much as the sin that was poured upon him, the wrath of God was released in the full measure upon him. And it is described that wave after relentless wave of the wrath of God came upon that person of Jesus Christ. All of us, this side of heaven, will never really be able to capture and appreciate that suffering, the passion of God. Most of us have seen the movie. Now it's been some years back. I went to see the movie just like many of you. I always felt coming up. The movie does not capture the skill, does not really capture the weight of the suffering of people. I was once asked by someone. He says, you say Jesus died on the cross. And when Jesus died on the cross, he bore the sin of the world. That he suffered. And he suffered to the uttermost. But do you know, if you read history, there were thousands and 10,000 who died on the cross. They also suffered. Jesus was no special. They also bore all the physical pain. Some even worse than Jesus. What the person was trying to tell me, of course it's not. He's trying to tell me that the pain of Jesus cannot be very long. Today I want to put to you, we read about the physical pain. We read about the emotional pain. But today, I want us to capture that it is the spiritual pain. The pain of a holy God bearing the darkness of sin. The
the flame of the wrath of God come upon you. We, after resting, and it was something that Jesus volunteered. It may sound like very clear, but when we apply our sickness unto the cross, and that time, something I have done again and again, that you will realize it is something personal. Be born of sin. Be born. So, when we say Jesus bore the sins of the world, we mean that half the sickness. So, when we say Jesus bore our my sin and your sin, I am not trying to get you on a guilt trip. Today, I'm not going to give you the luxury of listing down all my sins. Not next Sunday, I cannot come to church tomorrow. But what I want to tell you is, it is within you. But in the old man of God, was sent to his heart, one sick and never escaped. But to the extent you realize, where your sin, how that sin of yours, the depravity of you as a sinner, to the extent you understand that, to the extent you will appreciate Jesus taken, and to that extent will you say, I will love you. Now, this getting personal. But as much as our faith is a corporate faith, our faith is also a personal faith. So today, I want to bring this to you, that the Greek word chosen to represent Jesus dying on the cross is the word propitiation, apart from a normal atonement word. And if you read the NIV, if you read the NKJV, certain places they will use the word propitiation. If you use the NIV, they will not use the word propitiation, but they will use the word sacrifice of atonement. It's different from just the word sacrifice. The sacrifice of atonement. And it is the Greek word philosmo. And it is a word which brings in the wrath of God. That is what is so special about the word propitiation. Because that propitiation is a word that tells us that when Jesus was on the cross, that he bore the wrath of God, and in bearing the wrath of God, in being a substitute for us, in being someone who is covering up our sin by his death, that is the part where we say it's atonement. In sacrificing himself, that is where we say the sacrifice of atonement. In that act of bearing the wrath of God, he turned the wrath of God to the favor of God. And I sometimes wonder, when we hear the gospel preach these things, sometimes we have in a way diluted the gospel. And what I mean by diluting the gospel is, sometimes when we look to the cross and we say, God has borne the curses for me, and now I receive the blessing. It is true that God has borne the curses, that Jesus on the cross of Calvary has borne the curses, and through him we are blessed. It is true. But what I want to say is, what are you thinking of when you are thinking of the word, the blessings I shall receive? Are you thinking of money? Are you thinking of health? Nothing wrong with it. Are you thinking of things that are good? Are you thinking of something like a good life? Now, I want to say that I also think of those things. So, don't hurt it. It means, yes, it is part and parcel of the blessings that come from the cross. But what I want to say is, those are perishable. The cross of Calvary for the Son of God to come all the way down to earth, to be incarnated as a lonely man, to suffer abuse, to be mocked, finally to be raised up on the cross, to bear the wrath of God, is not merely that you will buy a better car. It's not merely that you will have a new house. It's the word merely. Because we will be blessed. But you will see beyond. And beyond this, it is primarily that the wrath of God that is upon us can be turned to the favor of God. By the grace of God, God has given me one blessing which I treasure. And through the years, God has blessed me in many ways. But when people ask me, I have always come back to this. God has given me a rest of the soul. God has given me a peace that surpasses all understanding. But how is it that I can find the rest and the peace? It is because I have this assurance. I am very aware. I am conscious that through the thick and thin of life, through the difficult circumstances of life, I have the favor of God. I always tell my friends that providential favor is upon me because I am a child of God. And why is it I can hold to it so tightly and so meaningfully is because I have the greatest blessing that happened to me. And I accepted Jesus on the cross, accepted Jesus and understood what he did on the cross for me was to turn God's wrath to God's favor for my life. That Jesus is indeed the sacrifice of atonement for me. He is indeed the propitiation for my sin. And this is what I want to bring to all of us, that Jesus bore relentlessly for 3 hours. And here is where I want to go down to verse 34. In verse 34, we have Jesus, and at the ninth hour, that's 3 p.m., 3 hours later of that barrage of the wave and wave of the wrath of God, finally Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" This is a very difficult verse in the Bible to interpret. We have many ways to look at it. Why did Jesus say, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Because in that climax, when the sin of the world was upon him, when such repugnant sin was upon the Son of God, there was a time we can only say God the Father turned his face. We can never really understand what happened, but we can just leave it there. And one, you must understand, sometimes it is not the circumstances that actually throw us down. It is the strength that we have that will always make us more than a conqueror. But in our spiritual weakness is what throws us down. When we go through our circumstances of life, if God be with us, if we can sense His presence, then whatever we go through, there is an overcoming strength. That is a more than conquering spirit that is in us. Why? Because my God is with me. We wonder why the martyrs can go to be martyred and tortured and at the end of the day stand tall for the faith, and their faith and their life has been an encouragement to all of us, and we wonder how they can do it, but we can't. Okay. But they can do it primarily because they are not alone. And when we come to this, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's a point from 12 o'clock, Jesus would sense the presence of God. He pulling through until 1. He pulling through until 2 o'clock. Because that awareness that the Father was with him, that awareness, that consciousness pulling through, it lasted until 2 o'clock. It lasted until the end. Moment when sin reached its climax, when the wrath of God reached the end of the climax, God the Father in that moment turned. And this is when Jesus shouted, "My God, my God, why did you forsake me?" It was momentary, but in that moment of that cry of anguish in the deepest parts of his heart, God did not let him stay long. Because if you jump 2 verses, you will find in verse 37, just after that, Jesus cried, "I thirst." It is finished. That's why in verse 37, with a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. In verse 38 is where the whole of this message ends. What happened was, just like in the Gospel of Matthew, the Apostle Matthew describes the same thing. The curtain of the temple was torn into from top to bottom. That the curtain in the temple was torn. It's very high up. I have not gone to check it the last time years ago. There is a few stories. From top to bottom, it tore. The curtain was separating the holy place from the most holy. The most holy place is what we call the Holy of Holies. It's what we call in Solomon's temple the place where they place the Ark of the Covenant. But by the 5th century, when the Ark of Covenant was already lost, by the time of Herod's temple, they already do not have the real Ark of the Covenant. But up down deep inside, most holy place, the Holy of Holies, is still where the presence of God is. Why they call it the most holy place? Why do they call it the Holy of Holies? It is so holy that even the appointed high priest can enter it only once a year. You just imagine, once a year, only on the Day of Atonement. And he has to cleanse himself for nearly a week and do all the necessary to prepare himself to enter with the blood of bulls and goats. The bull's blood to cleanse his own sin, atone for his sin and his household sin. The goat, the blood of the goat for the sins of the people of Israel. And he enters through the priest has to do it. same Jesus. When Jesus died on the cross, the curtain was torn from top to bottom. The Holy of Holies became open to all who come through the blood of Jesus. And you must understand the difference between the high priest and Jesus is, the first is, the high priest brings a sacrifice. And then after that, he gets pulled out. He brings the sacrifice. Jesus brings the sacrifice. He brings himself. Jesus is the high priest who brings the sacrifice, who is himself the sacrifice. And the other one is, you can read from the book of Hebrews that when the high priest enters from the holy place, he enters into the Holy of Holies where the presence of God is manifest. But when the curtain was torn, when Jesus enters, he enters right into heaven where God's presence is wholly manifest. So today, by the blood of Jesus, we are able to enter into the presence of God. That is why in Hebrews 4:16, the writer writes, let us enter the throne of grace with confidence, bold, because Jesus has opened a way for us. And I want to ask this question. When Jesus died on the cross, when he brought himself as a sacrifice, and he entered, when he entered into heaven, the curtain was torn, the way to heaven was open. What exactly was the power of the atonement? Our sins are atoned for. What exactly do we mean by propitiation, that the wrath of God has turned into the favor of God for us? What does it mean when we use the word atone, that our sins are already covered? God sees us through the righteousness of Christ. What exactly is that power behind that atonement? The atonement allows God to say, I am. And here is where we now turn to Luke chapter 24. The verse that I started. And I say this, forgiveness of sin. God forgives you. God sees the blood of Christ. God finds the atonement acceptable. God looks into the life of Jesus, who he is, a man without sin, and God says, I accept his sacrifice. But the power lies in the fact that when God accepts that sacrifice, when our sins are covered and atoned for, it is in this statement where God says, I forgive you. This is the power behind atonement. Why the atonement? Why Jesus has come all the way? Why he has to suffer so much? So that at the end of the day, each and everyone, when we come to God, God says, I forgive you. But you must understand this. The problem is not just God forgiving us. The problem is these two come together in verse 46 and 47. And in 47, repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations. Today, we as a church, we hold that treasure. We hold that salvational power which God has bequeathed to the church. We hold the power of the gospel. And the power of the gospel is in this simple line. When we see our friend, we tell him that God has forgiven you. That God forgives you. That is what God has done. I always say,
there are a lot of people ask me a lot of questions whether God loves, God has done enough for people, why people perish, why God is a part of it, all these things. I don't want to go into all that. I want to say that God has done for me. If you look back, God does not have to come. Jesus does not have to humble himself to take the nature of the man. Not going back. He does not need to go to the cross. But he did. And not only that, he does not need to bear the suffering that only he can understand. To bear that. But he did. Finally, after he has done all that, and he has come back to heaven, and he opens that way, and he tells all of us, come, because I have opened the way for you. And God says, I have forgiven you. And so many, they have no issue with the forgiveness of God. Whether you believe in God or you do not believe, I mean, it's always good to have a hope in God, just in case God is there, there's forgiveness, I have a whole mind, for people out of that, anything that will suffer, so that I can cover all of it. But the problem is this. The problem is the word repentance. And we, when we have the word repentance, we must be careful. And the word repentance is always read as a statement. Because in places in the Bible, saved by faith. In places in the Bible, it says repent and be baptized. And we know that the repentance of faith is a repenting faith. And it is there that we tell people that God forgives you. But to receive that forgiveness, you have to come to Him and repent. It is man's response. That is the issue. God. The way is open, but it is for man to actualize it and to walk along. And today, on Good Friday, I want to encourage all of us. And we as a church, we hold the power of the gospel unto salvation. And that power of the gospel unto salvation is the power where we can declare to people that God. And here, I want to summarize it like that. In forgiveness, we have touch. That forgiveness is the necessary prerequisite for fellowship. God forgives us in order to fellowship. And there is nothing more precious than fellowshipping with God. And here we have to understand that for all of us, when we receive the forgiveness of Christ, what is the difference when we are a spiritual baby, when we have just accepted the Lord, to a time that we have walked with the Lord for 20, 30 years? What is the difference? The difference is when I accepted the Lord in 1993, I marveled at the forgiveness. And never could really capture the essence of the fellowship. I was so thankful I am forgiven. But now, 25 years down the line, I am beginning to see, sense, and live the actualization of the forgiveness. That the forgiveness opens the door to fellowship. I want to encourage all of you. Fellowship is today. God has forgiven you. You have accepted His forgiveness. He comes to fellowship with you. But you must want to fellowship with Him. If you
you have a desire to draw near to Him, He will draw near to you. And here is where I want to encourage all of us. And you are asked by people, what is so good about Good Friday? When there is death, when there is all the crucifixion and all that is happening, how good is it? Now, what is good about Good Friday is in verse 38 of Mark, that the curtain of the temple is already torn. What is good about Good Friday is today, finally, we as people who are created in the image of God, whether you call Him your Father or you do not call Him your Father, we are all created in the image of God. Whether you are in church or you are not in church yet, you are created in the image of God. And that image of God yearns the presence of God. That image of God yearns to fellowship with God. And what is so good about Good Friday is in the statement where God says, I forgive you, it opens a way for you to fellowship with Him. And you shall experience the marvelous presence of God in your life. And God's wrath will turn to God's favor. So here is where I am ending. I'm really ending because my time is already fixed up. Okay? And I'm ending. And I want to put you how much you experience that forgiveness of God is reflected in how forgiving you are. I started by saying this. I struggle with unforgiveness. It does not mean I am the type of person and you say a little bit. And I say I struggle. There are only one or two people in my life. Right now, people who are not close to you cannot help you. It is people in whom you have invested your life, in whom you have given a lot of time. And the truth of God must be kept. To the former, to this day. And always remember, unforgiveness, the first thing I did for those 3 years, I did all the spiritual things. I prayed. I committed. I always committed. And just feel, I pray, just be the key. I just don't have the assurance at all. I read the Bible, but sometimes I the word just to my head. And I just want to. And I worship the leaves of it. But I realize that the heart won't be there. It just something that blocked me. It was a long time. And today, I am very confident that I do not want to go back to the old. I am encouraging all of you. People ask Jesus, how many times have I forgiven my brother for sins against me? But you, as a gift, which is for the one for you. Then when Peter is always a smart fellow, he will always try to outsmart people. And even when Jesus, he asked Jesus, up to 7 times, how was he trying to get him? To him, 7 times is important. To him, he's trying to get him. He was 7 times. seven times. This time you say, you know, the seven times. And I believe Jesus was surprised. Peter was surprised by the answer given by him. And Jesus answered him, what? 70 times 7. Your math tells you it's 490 times. And do you know 490 times? You have a math teacher, so you have to go into that. 490 times, you need to 100. You just divide. You do to 100 years, then you have 400. That means the guy, whoever it is, the girl, offends you 5 times a year, relentlessly for 100 years. Jesus said, okay. Which means Jesus saw through and here one happened. Unfortunately, the first thing is he will lose the experience of the presence of God. Like in Psalm 51, David lost his heart. He did not talk about losing his kingdom. He did not talk about losing his army. Says, do not take your presence away from the presence of the Holy Spirit. In him, that is the difference. So if you have unforgiveness for many years that are not going to be there, you lose the sense of the presence of God. You cannot really feel. The second one is not from the Bible, but probably from observing people, psychology or what we call it, unforgiveness. And that unforgiveness can be one of the causes of sickness. If a gay person releases and says, I forgive, suddenly, but I'm saying is, I think all these sicknesses, and here is where I want to say, this Good Friday, ask of the Lord to let you have a fresh revelation of how much Jesus did. And in Matthew 18, the parable of the unforgiving son. The parable goes like this. If God has forgiven you, in that parable, like a king forgiving someone who has owed him 10,000 times, then your brother or your sister offends you, it is just maybe worth 100 denarii. Very small. Let you remember that God has forgiven you much. Let us be gracious not to hold small grudges. My prayer today, afterwards, I'm going to pray for all of you that we will be able to capture the essence of Jesus on the cross that God has forgiven you. You want some time to be. And next time a brother or sister finds us, right now, if there's anything they're holding, look to Jesus and tell the Lord, I'm unable to forgive. But right in that place, the Lord will deliver you. Can I have faith? The worship team and the and we arise as we worship the Lord, and I want to pray for all of you.